Let me now go to the second story, which is medical. And this actually starts in 2003 when I met a surgeon, an orthopedic surgeon, in a biomaterials conference. So I come from metallurgical background. So some prof in metallurgy who knew me, he said, "Prof, come and talk about CAD-CAM to doctors." Okay. Now what I talked about is not really important, because one doctor who was there, he was talking about failures in medical implants. I mean, how many people talk about failures in life? People talk about successes in life. I was really surprised. So this doctor, Manish Agarwal from Tata Memorial Hospital, at that point of time, now he's in Hinduja Hospital. So he was talking about implants for children who have bone cancer. Mostly it is in knee joint. And instead of amputating the leg, he would open the leg, remove the knee joint along with part of the femur and part of the tibia, and then replace with a large mechanical joint which can give the walking movement back to the kids, right? So he told me, I was intrigued, and he told me, "Professor, if you want to come and see a surgery, you're most welcome." So I'm a bit of a sucker for adventure. So I said, "That sounds interesting." So let me go and see a surgery. So I saw that. That's the proof that I was there in the room. So, and that's how the surgery, surgical thing looks like. I haven't put the actual big picture of surgery because not easy to digest. It was actually difficult for me first time, because the blood is there, and when they cauterize, there's some kind of a smell is there. It's not easy to, all your senses are bombarded with different kinds of things. So it's very difficult to, but the doctor was good. In fact, he was saying, looking all the back all the time and saying, "Prof, are you okay? Are you okay?" I said, no, don't worry about me, worry about the patient, you know. So eventually we ended up over the next 5-6 years actually developing an indigenous implant. You can see the CAD model, the 3D printed plastic model, and you can see the metal model, which is better than the existing imported models. It is less than 1/5 the cost, or around that, okay. And it has a functionality which is suitable for our anatomy, our sizes. And as we speak, the manufacturing plant has been set up in Hyderabad in a place called NFTDC, and 5 hospitals have agreed to do the initial clinical trials, including AIIMS and TMH and other hospitals. And this will be rolling out, and we hope to see this actually making an impact. If I am not wrong, this is perhaps the most complex medical device developed in India so far. The device itself has about a dozen components. It comes in a large number of sizes. The instruments for surgery are again more than a dozen. We built a walking machine to test the joint for 10 million cycles of walking before we put in the patients. So all these are huge achievements by themselves. But that's a little older story. So what happened was then I started looking at what other stuff that India imports. That's how I came to know that India imports lot of devices, both for diagnostics as well as for treatment. And I also realized that we import almost like 80% of our 40,000 crores of medical devices every year. And when we look at our industries, there are hardly any companies worth talking about. In fact, hardly any companies who are certified with good manufacturing practice, which is essential for medical devices, and those who are there are actually very small companies. What is the reason? If you look at it, if you ask the doctors and hospitals, if it's a high-end device, if it's an implant or a complicated robotic surgical device, they will import it from the West, because they assume that is a lot of development has gone into that. They think it is much better reliability and quality and so on. But if it's some low-end stuff like some dental rails or let's say hospital beds and things like that, they import it from the East, increasingly China, Taiwan, Korea and so on. But our companies are now kind of hit from both sides. They can neither do low-end stuff at the cost of let's say China, nor high-end stuff with the kind of quality, reliability and the technology, of course, as from the West. So is there any hope for that? Yes, because the doctors are always asking for some new stuff. Doctors always want stuff which is even more affordable, more easily available, easy to use. They want stuff which is high quality in the sense that it should be more reliable, because we use and reuse and misuse our instruments, all kinds of environments. So we need much more robust instruments and equipment. And we also need equipment which is suitable for our requirements, not just patients, even doctors. Our doctors sometimes do 2, 3, 5 times the number of surgeries. So the ergonomics of the device and all kinds of things have to be more suitable for our conditions. So that is, there is a need, there is an unmet clinical need, as we say. But can we do that? Again, answer is yes, because recently we have had a lot of new things on the horizon. You look at 3D printing, you look at CAD/CAM, you look at medical diagnostic imaging, or you look at this cloud and big data analytics, you look at smart sensors, IoT. All these are new tools which actually enable us to maybe reinvent, rethink, redesign medical devices for our requirements, to meet the requirements of the clinicians. So the only way forward, in my opinion, is to innovate, for our companies to innovate. But to do that, you need to put people together. You need bio people, you need design people, you need mechanical, electronics, software people, management. We need to put all these people together, then only this can happen. Because if you look at any product, a product is not a mechanical product or electronics product or a bio product. A product is a product where you need all sciences coming together. Okay? And you said, and most of these software electronics where we said India has IT. Remember that, right? So this was happening, and then as luck would have it, the state government of Maharashtra, as well as the central government DST, they approached us and saying that, can you incubate a center where doctors and engineers can work together and create many more devices like that? So we started with that. They gave us 4 goals. They said, establish a minimum critical viable facilities, develop 12 devices. Fortunately for me, they never said which devices. It's like a blank check, any 12 devices. Okay. And then facilitate clinical trials and filing of patents and taking it forward to industry. And very importantly, create a few champions, a few innovators. Okay. And more recently, they also said that, can you create a model to sustain the activities on the longer term? So we had also kind of see whether we can earn some revenue in some way or fund the development further. So these 5 are the goals. The building which you saw behind was actually the place where they stored the costumes when 3 Idiots were shot in IIT Bombay. So it was a shed, unused, disused shed, and we built our lab in that shed. It's actually quite beautiful. If you step inside, we get to see 4 small labs. We have what's called as an idea room. An idea room is full of junk materials. So the beautiful stack which you see in the back is all filled with junk. So paper and electronics and broken mobile parts and camera parts and things like that. We use them to create proof of concepts. We don't want to go into 3D printing in the first step. We like to build things with hands first. And then we go into CAD, which is the second one on the right side, top. And then 3D printing, prototyping. And recently we also had electronics prototyping. We can actually print, we can actually design and print PCBs, printed circuit boards in our lab. So we have a pipeline, we have process now in place. It starts from a hackathon. Why hackathon? Because through the year we have doctors coming to us and saying that, hey, I have this great idea, why don't you work on that? Now we can't start working on it immediately because we get hundreds of ideas like that. We also get a lot of young people coming to us saying, oh wow, this looks like a good place, we would like to work with you. So what we do is we bring the ideas and the needs and of course these young people together in what we call as the medical device hackathon or Medha. It's a weekend thing. It starts on a Saturday morning and ends on Sunday evening. But in a weekend, they just build proof of concepts and show it to us. We know which combinations of ideas and innovators sound like a good thing to take it forward. So you take those winners to the next step, which is a week-long affair. It's called as Medical Device Innovation Camp. So for 5 days and 4 nights, they actually go to sleep at 4 a.m. and 5 a.m. and come back for my lecture at 9 a.m. four nights. Okay, and on the fifth day they have to stand on their feet and present what they have done. And it has to be a live working model. Okay, not so easy. And those who can stand up to that, we invite them as fellows for up to 1 year in our lab. And in the 1 year, they have a deadline to take the product, actually test it, show it to clinicians, and build a few proof of concepts, maybe a few 5-10 prototypes, even do some test marketing, put it in an exhibition. Because exhibition is an acid test. If someone is putting exhibition and a lot of doctors and even general public come and say that, oh, that's good, when can I use it? Or an industrial say, oh, can I manufacture that? Or a doctor comes and says, oh, can I use that? Then the innovator knows, yeah, I think maybe I should take it forward. And that's the time when you say, okay, now you do a startup. And Sign is our IIT's incubator. So they do the startup at that point of time. So the idea is, can we go from bed, that is hospital bed, to engineering bench, to business, back to hospital bed in less than 3 years for a low risk device, like a screening or diagnostic device or low risk device. That's the goal. And I'll just show you a few examples of one hackathon which we did in Mumbai last year. This was in a college called Somia Engineering College. And you can see the teams being formed. Every team has one doctor, one designer, one mechanical, and one electronics engineer. And that is the weekend thing. And then the winners come to this week long medic event. Again, same thing, but day one, we take them to hospitals. Day two, they build prototypes. Day three, they test it. Day four, we teach them how to do patent filing, business planning. And day five, they present the idea to a jury of doctors and senior industrialists and things like that. So those who want to go forward, we invite them to come and work with us for up to 1 year. You can see that we have all kinds of people in the sense that we have people with bio background. We actually have a doctor and biomedical and bioelectronics and people like that, biomaterials and so on. And then we have mechanical, metallurgy and materials and manufacturing people. That's the orange color there. And then we have electronics and software and computer science, those background, which is blue color there. So all these work together. What I told you earlier, bed to bench to business to bed. So we divide the whole thing into four quarters. So each step, you can say each phase is one quarter. And in one quarter, typically you have four steps. So we say that first form your team, then you do clinical immersion, which means you actually go stay, observe the clinical environment, see how doctors and patients and caregivers are working. And then you define a problem. We actually spend up to 1 month in just writing 1-line statement of what exactly you want to solve. It's amazing how much time we spend. And it's amazing how people jump into solving problems without understanding problems first. So we believe in defining a problem very, very well. And then initial concepts and feasibility check, then detailed design and prototyping and actually making functional prototypes, which is what researchers or engineers know. Usually in our academic institutions, we stop at this stage. Okay, but we say now go forward, test your device, create a good manufacturing practice. Okay, test it in lab, test it in the material characterization, maybe animal lab, maybe clinical trials, certification and so on. And then go even one more step forward, file your patent, create a business plan, then you scale up your, you need funding to scale up the whole thing. And of course, there's nothing like a first version, is a final version. Versions keep on improving. The interesting thing is that people also talk about this, they say that for every 10 ideas, you make one prototype, for every 10 prototypes, you make one product, for every 10 products, one goes into market. And for every 10 that goes in market, one is a success, they say. Now, that sounds like a very disappointing statistics, but it's not really true. The real thing is that if you do your due diligence, okay, and if you move your failures to upstream, okay, you can have much less failures in the late stages when it is more expensive. Early stages, it is much less expensive to fail. So, for example, we have listed about 400 different unmet clinical needs, which means some doctor has said that I need this device which is not in the market. But we don't pick up all those ideas. We actually do some shortlisting. We pick up only those ideas where there is a potential to innovate, which is feasible to do it. And some doctor says, I am with you. Okay. And then, you know, we have the right facilities for doing that and so on. So we have shortlisted about 100 of those. Those 100 we ran into hackathons and those clinics. We picked up 30 odd of those things, and along with the winners, those innovators who came and joined our labs, all of them have filed patents, by the way. And then out of those patents filed, about half of them are going into now production or clinical trials and so on. So if you see, interestingly, and maybe for policy or management, here is a nice insight. The ratios are from unmet needs to shortlisted, you can say maybe prototypes, is 4:1. From prototypes to, you can say, from proof of concepts to prototypes, it is 3:1. And from prototypes to products, it is 2:1. So actual, you can say, is only 2:1, because prototypes to products. That's still not 2:1, because many of the prototypes are still going forward and becoming products. It's a question of late, not necessarily not doing it. Okay. So let me just run through those four major steps. So once they come to our labs, we put them in hospitals. So we actually go and immerse. They actually see the how doctors are diagnosing or treating the patients. Increasingly, we go into operation theaters with permission, and of course, you have to follow certain rules. But we go into operation theaters, we videotape, we understand what is happening, because you can always play back and understand what could be the limitations or improvements possible. So over the last 3 years, since the BETiC started, we have now about 5 medical instruments, surgical instruments. We have about 5 odd diagnostic devices, and we have a few devices which are used for rehabilitation and custom medical devices. Now it'll take a long time, so I'll just pick one or two short stories out of these. One story I'll pick up is that of this boy called Sritam Raut. He came to me, and we put him with Dr. Suresh Deshpande. And the Suresh Deshpande is one doctor who can actually machine components. He can actually program computers. He has built his own voice-controlled robotic arm to position lights in his OT. Unbelievable. And he's from Kolhapur. So amazing person. So we met him, and he wanted a device when he does laparoscopic surgery, which is called keyhole surgery, and we are going inside stomach. And you want to reach organs which are sometimes not reachable with a straight instrument. He wanted an instrument which could even have a wrist kind of a thing at the end of, at the last part of the instrument. So we put him onto that. So Sritam went and studied, looked at laparoscopic surgeries. And the way we do innovation is we start with a simple paper model, and then plastic model, and then we go to metal model and so on. And over a period of time, he developed, about 1.5 years, he developed the final metal model. We actually found one industry. We were looking forward to entering this market, and so we gave this technology license to them. And then Dr. Suresh Deshpande, you can see him actually trying out the instrument. And as we speak, it is now entering production. So that means it will be actually available in market a few months from now. And this whole story from beginning, when Dr. Suresh Deshpande walked into our lab to the device entering the market, is less than 3 years. That is story number one, mini story inside the story. The second story I want to talk, picked up, is this digital stethoscope module. This is about Tapas, who is from Dehradun, and Adarsha, who is from a place called Koppa in Sringeri, near Sringeri in Karnataka, and Dr. Nambiraj, who is from Kolhapur. And Dr. Nambiraj, who is from a place called Varavalka Rural Hospital in near Chiplum. So they all three of them met in our medical device innovation camp, that 1 week camp. The first time they meet, the first time they make a team, and Dr. Nambiraj said, my problem is that in a village rural hospital, some patient, let us say, comes with breathlessness, and let's say put a stethoscope, and I see that he is breathing, or let us say his heart rhythm is irregular, but I do not know how critical it is. If only I can put the stethoscope here, but some expert in a city can listen to that and tell whether it's emergency or not. That was a dream. That was a problem specified. And these three people in a matter of just 3-4 days, they actually built a prototype. And then the last day, fifth day, when they had to present the whole thing, they actually put a stethoscope on one guy, and then the loudspeakers are putting the heart sound out, you know, literally, and without any wires connected. It was amazing. And then they decided to leave their jobs. They were all in jobs. And both Tapas and others have left their jobs. They came to BETiC, joined. And in the last 1 year, they have developed that module, that blue module which you see in this picture, which can actually convert any ordinary stethoscope. You just remove the tube and the chest piece, put this module in between that, it becomes a digital stethoscope. What it means that it can now enhance the sound, cancel the noise, you can record and playback, and eventually they are planning to do many more wonderful things as well. And then they applied for this biotechnology ignition grant, big grant, and they won the grant recently. They started a company now, and as we speak, they are finalizing their design, putting the vendor network in place, and they hope to be able to put the device in market sometime this year. Again, from beginning to end, less than 3 years. Okay. The last story I will tell you here is about what is called as Jaipur foot or Jaipur leg. We mentioned that in the beginning, that is how Jaipur leg looks like, the one which is given to actually 500,000 people all over the world. And these patients come to various centers all over the country. Jaipur foot is not a licensed process, anyone can copy that, and anyone can adapt it to their own local conditions. So there is one NGO called Ratnanidhi Charitable Trust, which is based in Bombay, who have given more than 50,000 free legs using this process to patients all over India and also Nepal and Africa and so on. So the owner of or head of this NGO, Mr. Rajiv Mehta, he came to me again by luck. One fine day, just walked into my lab and just curiously to see what is happening. And I paid a visit to him next day itself. And he said the problem is that the socket that we put on the stump of the patient, if the socket and the stump do not match perfectly, you have high pressure points. And when you have high pressure points, the patient will feel pain and the load is not distributed properly. Eventually, you can even get infection and things like that. So he said that can you make a process to make the socket more efficiently, more accurately, with less skill if possible, because it is done manual process, a lot of skill is required. They use plaster of Paris and do a lot of finishing and all those things. So we said, okay, maybe we should use our CAD-CAM and 3D printing knowledge for doing that. So we brought those technology in. But again, one more problem is that in Jaipur leg, the patient can either walk with a straight leg, you can't bend the leg. Only when you want to sit, then you de-link the top and bottom portion of the leg and then you sit. But then it's only dangling at that point of time. So can you walk more naturally was one desire. Patients as well as NGOs and we also thought like that. As luck would have it, just at that point of time, we had Dr. Sujata Srinivasan at IIT Madras, who had developed this knee joint. She was looking for someone to fit into a prosthetic leg. So I just met her by accident in one conference. I said, can we use your knee joint? We put it together. And therefore, we have now a new design where we have a socket that can be designed much more ergonomically for each patient suitable to that. Then you put a knee joint and connect it to that. We are now actually also inventing the ankle joint into that. And we put this now into initial patients and we have tried and then see to how they are walking and so on. So all these devices which I mentioned to you, I mean starting from those surgical instruments to diagnostic devices to these rehabilitation devices, they have actually touched patients, they have actually gone into industry, some of them are into production, they have gone into hospitals, doctors are actually using some of these. We reckon we have touched already more than 150 patients. Okay, and you can see the Jaipur leg, the person walking more natural gait. And we're actually even checking the gait in a gait lab to see how more natural we can make it. So this is the impact, you can say, what we could do in medical domain. So we give these platforms to the innovators. The story doesn't end there. We actually ask these innovators to put their devices in exhibitions. We have organized our own exhibitions. We also put them in exhibitions by other organizations. You can see our S&T minister, Sri Harshvardhan ji, looking at our prosthetic leg. And we also tell the innovators to go all the way, file patents. We have filed a record 35 patents in the last 2 years or so. And then, but more importantly, many patents are actually going forward into commercialization. We have a very nice revenue sharing arrangement involving clinicians, because we feel the doctors are very critical part of the whole team. So they must also be part of revenue sharing and credit for that whole thing. And then we have examples of how we take the devices through startups or by licensing to Indian companies. And if it's an NGO who wants to give it free of cost to end users, we give the licensing also free of cost. So we have three models really of taking the idea all the way to society. And those are examples of companies or organizations which have taken it forward. And we are sharing the information in different ways. So the stories of 16 innovators who were in BETiC, who invented all these devices, we have compiled them into one book called as The Essence of Medical Device Innovation. Crossword is going to publishing that. It will be out in a few more days as we speak. And then we have our website, our booklets. All these are meant to share our how we are doing, what we are doing, and so on. So that is what is Golden Spiral all about. So how do you take an idea? And it comes from looking outward, not sitting in our offices and labs and classrooms, going out into real life, real world, looking at the problems, understanding that, and involving people. You can tell stories, see who is interested, who is passionate about solving that. As someone said, India has all kinds of problems. You can pick one good problem and it will take your lifetime to solve it completely. So pick a good problem, but you need to find people who are passionate about solving the problem and then take it forward. So this is see, tell, try and test. And if you keep doing it again and again and again, that's how you make an impact. So what is the framework for doing that? So let me just share the last few insights here. The framework is that when you say product, the product doesn't come up just like that. It starts from an idea and then you create a prototype and then product and then finally market and impact, right? How do you do that? It is done by people, right? And people are initially just, they come as interns. Someone shows an interest, I say, okay, come and sit in our lab for 3 days, 1 week, 1 month, intern, okay? And then if he shows a lot of interest, then we say, okay, now do you want to become an innovator? Then you start doing a project. And then if he or she wants to become an entrepreneur, we facilitate that. Eventually, we want them to become mentor and eventually thought leaders. But what is it that creates these kind of people to start with? You need to have process in place. So the process which I described to you, it starts with defining a project or defining a problem, defining an unmet clinical need, to developing a solution, and then testing, delivering, and deploying in actual real life. The process is what creates or identifies, nurtures, and creates the people. From there you get your products. In a way, it's like the process is like your soil in which the trees will grow, and that's what will give you the fruits and flowers. So the framework for doing that is what people have to grasp. Only those who have done all these things, maybe themselves if possible, or the team which has done it together, they understand the framework and then they can implement that in institutions. So if I can summarize the entire thing into one slide, one nutshell, I would say we need three things to create these things in different places. We need it in every place, we need it in every institution. One is critical infrastructure, which is visible, we can put it into place. So we need rapid prototyping, we need metal prototyping, plastic prototyping, electronics prototyping, and so on. We will need software for design and simulation. We need testing of those products, we need of prototypes. We need places where we can create the first few batch of 10, 20, 25 products. That is the first part of it. The second thing is, of course, people or team structure. The critical thing here is that multidisciplinary. We say that innovation happens at intersections of disciplines. So you need faculty from different disciplines, innovators from different disciplines, researchers from that. We need to have managers who manage the process, technicians who manage the equipment, and we have a continuous team of experts. We reckon that on average, every day, at least one, if not more, visitors are coming to our lab, and these are of all kinds of people. They could be builders, they could be policy makers, they are of course administrators, they are of course clinicians and industry and engineers and so on, but all kinds of varieties of people. Of course, we are not, don't yet have African poets and architects and things. I wish we had even more variety like that. So one is, second thing is your people, bringing them together. The third part is culture, which is not visible at all. We only feel it when you experience the culture for some time. The culture is about, one is of course, I tell them that innovation happens at intersections of disciplines. So when you say biophysics, I'm very happy to hear that. Okay. Biostatistics, mathematicians and biology. Okay. Biomechanics, bio and mechanical people and so on. There's so many disciplines, I don't think we can even count anymore how many interdisciplinary fields are there these days. So that is important. So people have to work together with each other. Second thing I tell them is that you have to get feedback continuously. Don't wait to make the most perfect or beautiful prototype and then show it to doctors. In fact, the danger is that, one is that if you spend 1 year and then show doctors, they may say, oh, there's already invention like that, or maybe it is not useful or something else. Better show it early. Fail early is what we say. Fail quickly. The other danger is that if you create a very beautiful product, you fall in love with your own innovation and you don't see anything else. You become blind to other ideas which may be there. So you say quickly create prototypes, quickly fail. Increases failure rate in the beginning, which is easy and inexpensive, and reduces failure rates later, which is much more expensive. And things like, we tell them that you always focus on the end users. I tell them you put a picture of the patient you saw in the hospital. Imagine that you're trying to solve the problem for that patient. Then whatever you do, whatever you think, whoever you meet, you're focusing energies on solving that problem. So all these ingredients cooked in the fire of real life projects is what makes our beautiful dishes. Okay, but that is a problem still. The pilot batch production is a tricky issue. That's the second valley of death. We do not have facilities where you can just take a prototype and get 10 pieces, beautifully designed, beautifully manufactured and tested. There's no place, single place under one roof in the country as far as I know. And we need these places if we want to create many more innovations and ensure many more innovations go into products and markets and eventually impact. We need to work on that. So I more or less stop there, and just maybe to wind up by saying that if you really want the right results in life, they come from right actions. You would agree with that, right? But right actions, how do you know what is right? People say you need to have right vision. But vision is a misused word often. And you see vision statements, and many times when you ask the organization, some employee, what is vision statement of your organization? Good chance he or she may not be able to articulate that very well. So I say that more than vision, what is important is your intention. So when I say that your intention is to solve that problem for the category of people that you see who are maybe unprivileged, if you can help them in some way, if the intention is right, that leads to right vision, that leads to right action, and if these three are right, the results will be right by and large. So I'll end here, and thank you so much.